Hello, Google developers, and welcome to this week's episode of Google Plus Developers Live. Today we're going to be talking about targeted sharing on Android. I'm Gus Klass, a developer programs engineer for Google Plus, and with me here is Chirag Shah.
I'm Chirag Shah, and I'm a software engineer on the Google Plus Android SDK.
So great. So today we're going to be talking again about configuring and targeting interactive posts on Android. We'll also talk about kind of how you can think about targeting these posts on Android. So as I go through the code, Chirag here, our Android expert, will be giving us some pointers on what's going on behind the scenes and some more information on development with Android for Google+. So before we begin, Chirag, do you want to tell us a little bit more about interactive posts?
So interactive posts bring users directly to your app or website with a call to action button. Clicking the call to action button will bring recipients to a specific place in your app where they can perform an action.
Awesome. So before we get into the code, let's start with configuring the application from the developer console. So on my screen, you can see the Google APIs console open. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new project. And then I'm going to give this a meaningful name. And just so that you know, this is also documented on developers.google.com/plus/quickstart/android. And so if you want to get started on there, it's an easy way to quickly get going with developing on Android. So all the steps that I'm seeing here are also documented on the web if you want to follow along. So after I've turned on the Google Plus service, then I'm going to enable API access by creating an OAuth2 client ID. And again, you'll just have to put in a meaningful product name here. And then after you've done that, you're going to set up an Android application. So this is going to be an installed application. It's going to be installed onto Android devices. And so then I'm going to click Installed Application and then click Android. And there's two parameters that I'm going to have to fill out here. The first is going to be the package name. And then you just put in the app name here that you'll get from your Android project. And then the second is going to be the signing certificate fingerprint. And this is creating this fingerprint, you're going to use the key tool, which is a thing that allows you to extract information about your developer certificate. Chirag, do you want to talk a little bit more about this signing certificate?
Yeah, so what we're doing here is identifying our Android APK or Android project with Google and allowing our Android project to talk to these various services. What we're doing here is extracting the SHA-1 hash of the signing certificate for the debug certificate. And that allows us to keep developing before we go to production. Once we go to production, we'll get a different production key store and extract the certificate from there and generate the SHA-1 hash from there and register it again with Google before going to production.
Awesome. So if we look at my screen again, you can see that I loaded up my console and I've got the command for exporting this, this certificate. And so what you would do is after you run that command, then you copy in this SHA-1 hash, paste it into your console, and then your project is pretty much set up at this point. We're going to do one more thing before continuing, and that is we're going to enable deep linking. So when I click this radio button and then turn on deep linking, it'll let me use deep links from within my Android app. Yeah. Chirag, can you give a little bit more information on deep linking in Android apps?
Yep. So deep links allow users to share the exact state of an application on Google+. When the post is viewed on a mobile device, the user will be directed to the exact state that was shared on Google+. If the user doesn't have the app installed, they'll be prompted to install it on their mobile device. Ready to start diving into code, Gus?
Yep. Just one second. I'm going to set up this. I'm going to set up the project. And so if you look on my screen, you'll see that I have set up an Android project that has been. It's all been configured within the APIs console and is ready to go. And this is also the exact same project that ships in the Android SDK. So all this code is pretty much already available to you. And what I've done is I've added some functionality to this sample app that we'll talk about in just a minute. But let's first look at the plus share code. So this is inside of the share activity. And within that share activity is an intent that is returned and used to render that share dialog. And in order to set this up, the first thing that we do is that we use the plus share builder to construct a plus share object, and then we configure parameters from within that builder. Chirag, can you give us some more information about these parameters as we look through the code?
Yep, so we use the plus share builder to create an intent to the Google Plus app to display the share dialog. This builder helps us configure the share dialog to display exactly what we want. We use the add call to action button to configure the red call to action button in the share dialog. So here in the sample, we're configuring the share dialog to display the view item call to action. We also configure what happens once that button is clicked. So we pass in a call to action URL and a call to action deep link ID. The call to action URL is used on desktops, and the deep link ID is consumed on mobile devices. Next, we set the content URL. The content URL helps us define what data gives context to the user about which action they're going to perform. So in this case, we're setting the content URL to our developer documentation. And from there, we've annotated it with schema.org markup, which displays what description should show up in the share dialog, and also what type of image should augment and give more context to the user.
Awesome. So there's two sets of links that we're really talking about here. So I'll get this started so we can see what's going on. There's two sets of links here. The first set is the content links, and then the second set is going to be the call to action links. So want to differentiate between these a little bit, Chirag?
So the content URL is used around the call to action. So it's placed on top of it, as you can see in the share dialog. And once you click on it, it points users to the particular resource that's being shared. Whereas for the call to action URLs, it basically guides the user to perform a particular action in that application. And the deep link IDs are used for mobile clients to navigate users to the particular resource that's being shared.
OK, awesome. So if we look at my screen again, we can see the sample running on my phone. So this is the same sample that you know and love that ships with the SDK. And this is as it would run just as if you hadn't made any changes yet. So when I go through the interactive post, click this create the interactive post, and I click go, what you'll see is you'll see the same thing that you see on my screen. You see the pre-filled text that is from this line of code here. You'll see the content URL, which is going to be rendered on this part of the screen near the bottom. And then you will see this view item a call to action button. So if I'm correct, the call to action links will determine which content appears inside of this button, and then the content is what appears inside of that little rendered area on the bottom of the screen.
Exactly. So the content URL gives a little more information to the user about what's being shared and what type of action they would be performing once they click on the call to action button.
Awesome. Thanks, Chirag. So I'm going to go look at one more thing. So if I click on who this post is being shared with, the little dialog box that appears on the top of the post, I'll notice that it's set to public. Now, where did that public come from, Chirag?
It's a good question. So that's actually the last share target specified in the Google Plus share dialog. So last time you shared on Google Plus and filled out some people, it'll get displayed again. But we can do a little better with interactive posts. We can actually set a specific set of people in the share dialog and actually get targeted sharing. So with the plus share builder, you can specify the method set recipients. And from there, you can set the exact share target that your application wants.
Awesome. So let's return to the code here. And here's that set recipients method. And what I'm going to do later on in the code is I'm going to create an array list of recipients that I'm then going to use for the builder method for set recipients. So I've cheated a little bit here, and I've already written a lot of the code. But let's walk through the important sets of the code so that you can kind of understand what's going on here. So when I turn on that best flag, what's going to happen is instead of just starting the activity, what I'm going to do is I'm going to call this method load people. And what that is it's an implementation of an interface that's specified by the Google Plus platform. And so if you look at the very top of my code, you can see where I have copied and pasted this on people loaded listener from the list people activity. And what that will do is when that method is called, this callback function for onPeopleLoaded will be called. And then inside of here will be data. Sharad, can you give some more information on kind of how these pieces connect?
Yeah, so when you call plus client.loadPeople, it's actually an asynchronous call. And Google Play Services will go out to the network, fetch the specific set of people as determined by the network, and return that back to your application as specified by your callback interface. So once the people have been loaded, it'll specify a person buffer, pass a person buffer into the onPeopleLoaded handler. And person buffer is actually a cursor-like interface. And once you're done loading the specific people from the buffer, you'll have to close it as to avoid any memory leaks.
OK, so awesome. So we have this buffer. So we have this person buffer. And then we can take those objects, and then we can add them to this array list of best recipients. And then later, before we call this, or before we retrieve this intent, and then we start the activity for result, what will happen is we'll have that list of people already added into the data that's set up by the share dialog. So while this loads, do you want to talk a little bit about why you want to call start activity for result?
So when you call start activity result, it gives attribution to your calling package and helps render the share dialog with attribution. And you'll need to do this for interactive posts or it won't work.
OK, so there you go. Make sure that you call start activity for results so that it works. So let's run the same code that we ran before now that we set that we set the recipients for this post. So if everything worked correctly, what we'll see is we'll see the list of the best recipients. This is something that's worth mentioning. When I perform that method, load people, it's doing a list of the people using the Google Plus platform API. And this allows you to sort by alphabet, or it allows you to sort by best. And so I've done a sort by best. And so the top five best people that are associated with my demo account here will be returned to my app. So if we look at the list here, so here's the five people. And this looks good. Chirag's missing. I don't know why, because he's one of my best people. But there's also something else that's different. You'll notice that that list of recipients that we had set before, public, is no longer there. Chirag, why is this happening?
So back when we called plus share, back when we called the set recipients method in the plus share builder, we set the specific share target for the share dialog. And that actually overrode the previous share target, because our application is specifying exactly who should be shared with.
OK, so that's it for today. You've seen us taking the content, or you've seen us taking an interactive post and then adding specific recipients to it so that you can create a much more contextually useful and relevant post for your users. And next, what we've done is we set up that post and then rendered it to the stream. And then with that, when you set that list of recipients, then you're ready to go. So it looks like we may have some questions.
We do have a couple questions. Thanks, okay. Gus. So one question is from Gerwin. He wants to know about if there's a way to have a deep link ID, but still allow people to access the content URL if they don't want to install the app for some reason. So the question is there a way to have a deep link ID, but still allow people to access the content URL if they don't want to install the app for some reason?
OK, so you have a deep link ID, but you don't.
Oh, so that won't work right now, but that is really good feedback. And that's something I'll take back to the appropriate teams.
So another question, Gus. I was a little concerned you showed your best people and you didn't have your friendly GDL producer listed in that top five. How does Google Plus determine that affinity of who gets in that top five? And what do I need to do to get in that top five?
So I don't have the specific information here. It is calculated by Google based on the available information that Google has and the interactions that you have on Google Plus. So be a very friendly person and do all the great things that would make you a close friend of mine, and then you would appear in my best friend in my best friends list.
Over on YouTube, there was another question. Chirag, how does somebody get such an awesome shirt as yours? They want to get this Google API shirt. And do you have multiple, and can you give some of those away?
This is actually a limited edition, and we no longer make these type of shirts, but
Was the shirt deprecated?
Yes.
It's a deprecated shirt. So I believe Google may also have, they may have a store where you can get, you know, some of the Google branded stuff. I don't know specifically where that is, though.
Yeah.
GoogleStore.com.
GoogleStore.com. All right. Any final questions? All right, so that's it. Everything that we've shown today is well documented on the Google Plus Platform Developers page, developers.google.com/plus. And we also, like the sample that we showed for Android is available from the SDK. And so if you you go to the documentation page that I showed you earlier, you can find the sample.
And you can also find all of our samples on github.com/Google+, where you can find samples in all of our supported languages. And they also demonstrate the best practices for integrating with Google+. I find this to be the best resource when trying to learn a new language, such as Go or C#. Because it shows how to integrate with Google+, but it also shows how to use that language and make typical REST calls.
It's really great to hear that feedback, Chirag, because when we created the samples, we tried to create them as consistent as possible so that if you're switching from one language that you're comfortable in and moving to another one that you're less comfortable in, you can understand what's going on inside of the sample. It's worth mentioning that we also have additional support materials. If you go to developers.google.com/plus, and then go on the left nav, you can find additional information about our support communities, such as Stack Overflow, where we use the tag Google-plus, and also the community page on Google+, where a lot of developers are engaging with each other all the time. So that's it for today. Chirag, thank you so much for coming in. It's great to have an Android expert on here.
Thank you for having me on, Gus.
All right, so until next week, stay around and be sure to watch as we have future episodes of Google+ Developers Live.